the idea is I want to show three ways of working with and handling APIs. They have existed for a long time, the concept of APIs, but especially with the increase of architectures based on microservices, we see a necessity to connect all these different services. And a very common way to do that is to set up a REST API interface. So what is an API? An API is a way to make two services or two machines able to speak together. And what you usually, or what you often do, what I will present today, is you let them speak together in JSON, just a text format, but there are also other alternatives. When you do this kind of stuff, it quickly becomes difficult to make sure that the service that you provide, especially if you want to expose a public service, that it is able to handle any kind of load. So stability issues quickly become difficult. You also want to make sure that it's sufficiently secure so that your infrastructure or your own system isn't exposed in any unfortunate way. You also want to provide proper documentation for the developers who are going to use your APIs. And you want to make it easy for developers to connect to your APIs and to use them in their applications. So in this presentation, I'm going to show kind of three steps or three ways to do this, where we start with the most kind of simple home-baked solution and then move on to Cloud Endpoints, one of the GCP products, and then Apigee, which is now also a Google product, but which was previously an independent enterprise. So let's see if I can get this to work with all these screens and stuff. We have, I think, a service running somewhere. If I can find, yes, here we are. So I built this small application. It is in need of being increased in size. Uh-oh. Yeah. I think we just need a small refresh. Oh, of course, it's because I'm not online. That's great. Sorry. Here we are. Phew. We have this small application. It's based on Google's one of their documentation example applications where you just provide data about some books. And you can browse around and you can edit them and stuff like that. This is UI, but actually this is not what we're going to look at now. We're going to look at the API of the service, which I want to zoom in a bit on. So when you hit the endpoint for this service, if you try to take the no security solution, oh, who turned off the lights? Okay, thank you. This is just a simple API call. We call localhost right now because that's just that's where you always start your application, right? You make it on localhost, and we get some data back about the books in our database. How do we make sure that the right people get access and the wrong people don't? Well, of course, we need some kind of authentication. You may want to make a completely open and public API. You can do that, and if you have the resources to handle any kind of load, it can be fine, but maybe you want to restrict it a little bit more just to make sure that you don't get too many unintended visitors. And an intuitive way to get started on that is, of course, to implement your own security. why can't you do that? Should that be so hard? I don't want to show you, actually, how that can be done because it's not well done. Generally, if you start implementing your own security, don't, because it's probably not going to be that good. Instead, if you want to do it in your, inside your own application, find it with some providence or with some due consideration, find a package that you trust within your software environment that will be able to handle authentication in a robust and secure way in your application. That can get you pretty far. And I think if you are willing and ready to kind of maintain the duty that it is, that you also kind of handle authentication inside your own application, you can do that. But often, at least if you grow, or if your application grows, you might at some point feel a need of getting better observability to your application. You may be interested in seeing how it actually performs under load. You may want to see what happens when it fails. You may also want to get better control of which kind of people have access. Or maybe you want to have more complex authentication schemes like JSON web tokens, or you want to integrate with the native SDKs for iOS or Android when you start working on your mobile app, these kind of things. If you are thinking about that kind of stuff, then Google Cloud Endpoints can be a good place to see if that can solve your problems. What they do is they give you access to these kind of extra kind of features with relatively low setup. The way that it works is that you have your own API backend application, and then in front of that, you configure a proxy that receives all traffic to the endpoint that you expose. And in that layer, you will then handle authentication, and it will handle load balancing. It will make sure that you don't get any uninvited visitors. And it also means that if there are a lot of unauthenticated requests that just need to be rejected, you will never get those requests to your application. It will just be rejected at the Cloud Endpoints layer, and you won't get that traffic, you won't get that load, and you won't have to pay that money. The way you configure it is that you you define such an open API file. Is this big enough? Barely, but maybe I can just zoom in a bit. Then we'll take this away. This looks awful. So how many here have worked with open API or Swagger? Maybe that's what it was. Yes, okay, so that's a fair bit. How many have implemented these kind of configurations? A few also, that's cool. Just to give an impression of what it looks like, there is first a bit of kind of header information about your application, a little bit about what kind of data you expose and what it receives. And then you define some routes that you expose in your application. So you have a base path if you want. And then here I have exposed two paths, books and books/ID, and then the ID is kind of a variable that you pass on to your application, and then you get back the book that has that ID. And then we have a little bit of specification of what kind of responses we can have and a little bit of documentation. And then if we look, we see this schema, and then we have a ref. That's because down here in the bottom, when we go down a bit, we have definitions of the schemas of the answers. So you define the types and the structure of the objects that you get back when you make these requests. And finally, in the bottom, we have a little bit of security. And this is, so to keep this simple and also to make it realistic to try to say something in about half an hour, I just show examples with API keys because that's simple to explain. It's also simple to implement. But you could also do it with other kind of more sophisticated authentication schemas, of course. But all this kind, all this stuff you then define in your OpenAPI specification. And then actually all you have to do is to, let me just find a command, not that it's important, but just to show you that it's not much more than that. I think we can stop our local host here. Then you run this gcloud endpoint services, you set up a proxy service, deploy, and then you give it the configuration file. Then it deploys that cloud endpoint, and then you have a proxy set up. Now you only need to connect that with your application. And what we do here is we deploy our application. We could do it in Cloud Run, but because I don't want to steal Kevin's thunder, we will do it today in App Engine instead. So this is, it's incredible. It can be, even on this Zoom level, you can see the whole configuration in, on the screen. To deploy the application on App Engine, you just tell it it's a Ruby application. You deploy it on App Engine Flexible. You tell it what how to start the application. And then the important part in terms of the cloud endpoints is that you tell it that it has an API service endpoint. And then this here will be the URL of the application when it's deployed on App Engine. This means that instead of pointing this URL to your App Engine application itself, just the kind of the naked backend, it points to the proxy that is in front of it. And then all requests will be routed on to your backend application. This means also that once you deploy this, and try to access it, let's try, actually. I'm not 100% sure how this is going to work. But if we access that endpoint now, because it should be running with the cloud endpoint set up, there won't be any access, because now where before we had our UI at the root level of the application, now there is nothing because this route, the root, is not registered in endpoints. So we can never get into the application, so to speak, through an HTTP request. The only thing that is exposed is what you define in your OpenAPI definition. That means that in terms of access, you can only get access to what we define, what we let the users get access to. So if you try to see in Postman here our kind of API tool, let's take it first in the browser. That's more visual. What you see here, by the way, is that here is a key, an API key that you generate in the GCP console. And until you generate a key, you cannot get access. So if we remove this, we will again see that the method doesn't allow unregistered callers. But if we put it in, it should work, yes. Then we get all the books. Yes?
It's the load balancer that doesn't give you access.
Yes. So the first denied access attempt will never touch our application. It is rejected at the proxy layer. So these kind of requests you never need to handle or think about. Yeah. Does it work here? Yes, it should. Yes, here we have it also in the kind of prettified version. And this, I would say, if you have a system that mostly has internal APIs. If you, let's say you have a big organization where you need to organize communication between services within your organization, this can get you really far because Cloud Endpoints handles all the security, handles all the load balancing. And it also gives you a way to create API keys and to define who has access. You may correct me if I'm wrong, but as I found it to work, there is no, the way that it works with the API keys is not super flexible. Because either an API key is connected, an API key is connected to a GCP project, which means that you either need to generate these API keys inside the project that runs your application or inside another GCP project that you give access to your application. This means that if you have a consumer application that doesn't run on GCP, then you need to generate an API key inside your own project. But identification of users is on the project level, which means that you cannot see which applications are using your endpoint if you give them your own API keys from your own GCP project. So long story short, it's not that flexible how you handle users and usage with this kind of setup. You can provide quotas, so you can say this API key cannot use more than this and that many requests a minute or a day or whatever. And that gives you something, but there isn't kind of a strong or coherent model of the user. And that I have found to be a challenge. Yes. No. Yes, unfortunately enough, with the Cloud Endpoint setup, you can only use it in the query parameter.
Let's assume we have a hard some service that has hard-coded URLs.
Yes. Thank you. That's another example of where you may run into a roadblock. There may be ways around it, but as I have done this, as I have understood this, the query parameter is a strict requirement. Okay, so what do we do then? How about this thing called Apigee? That is kind of, you can say that in a sense, maybe Apigee is the big brother to the Cloud Endpoint solution. Now that Google has taken Apigee in as a Google product, at least that's how I see it. I'm sure what I'm going to show now is just the basics. It's really an incredibly complex system. It's a very, very strong system, a rich system. It takes a little bit of getting used to, and I'm sure it's also pretty expensive, but I honestly don't know because you cannot see the prices. What it does, however, is it provides you with a strong story of how you handle security in a good way. It is very flexible in how you handle limiting of quotas of rates, how many requests from which type of users. There is a strong concept of the user. It is easy to make different types of API products. So say you have basically the same, that's what I'm going to show, the same backend, the same application, but then you have a basic, a premium, and a gold tier subscription that have different levels of access, they have different levels of quotas, that kind of stuff. It's relatively simple to manage in Apigee. You can do much, much more. But just to show you a couple of examples of what it looks like. Let's see. So this is the administration backend of the Apigee. This doesn't work. Of the Apigee system, and it's based around these API proxies. So just like It works as a proxy in the same way as cloud endpoints that you put up in front of your application. And if I were to make a new one, I can even use OpenAPI as a definition. And if we try that, I won't go through it now because it will take a little bit too long, but just to show you that you can get going pretty fast. We see that all the details of our application is already filled in the into the form because that all comes from our OpenAPI specification. And it knows the endpoints that I want to expose. It knows the methods. It knows the whole schema of the data. All that it just pulls out of the specification. So you can get up and running pretty fast. If I had pressed next, 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 save, go, and all that, now you would then see something. I'm not going to do it because it will just leave you guys waiting. You would see something like this. The way Apigee works is it has this concept of proxy endpoints and target endpoints. Proxy endpoints are the endpoints that you expose to your user developers, the applications that are going to consume your API. And there you can have any number of proxies that expose your services. And then you have your target endpoints, which are your backend applications. So here we have our small book application. And what it does is it just routes in very much the same way as endpoints. It just routes traffic to the appropriate endpoints. What is cool is you can have a lot of these. So if you have a big system that contains maybe 15 or 20 different complex services, you can use Apigee as a service you put in front of that. And then in Apigee, you administrate all that traffic. So you have a request that may need data from 3 different or 5 different endpoints. Apigee gets that data and assembles that into a coherent answer to your end user application. That is a really power and a flexibility that you don't get in endpoints. Anyway, let's see what it looks like if we try to. So here's the overview of our application. If we go into develop, we can see here we have our target endpoint. And of course, what you see at first is it's all XML. Yes, that's the way it is. We cannot do much about that. You get used to it. And it's actually it can be fine enough. Our target endpoint is our backend application. And then we have one proxy endpoint, one kind of public endpoint. And then you see this concept of pre-flows and post-flows. What that does is it lets you have different types of operations, transformations, on the data before you send a request and when you receive an answer from a service somewhere in kind of a system of requests. So what we do here is we, in our configuration of the connection between our Apigee endpoint and our backend, we still use cloud endpoints because we still want our service to be secure. And that means that if we just exposed our unsecure app engine deployment without anything in front of that, then if somebody snatches up this URL, then the whole system that we have built here to ensure that we have authentication and it's locked down and all that, that's out the window. So we still need, or I would recommend at least, still to have cloud endpoints in front of your backend application and then to have this in front of cloud endpoints. And what we then do, in this case, you could do it more sophisticated. What we do then is we, when we get a request, before we send that on to our backend, we put in an API key from cloud endpoints. So we do that at this layer. And at the public layer of the API, we check that the request has the correct public API. And how do you handle that? I'll just show that as a last thing, because this is one of the things that becomes very easy in Apigee. If you go into this section that's called publish, they have this concept of products. And that's where you assemble a number of proxies or a number of endpoints into a coherent product. And when you have defined a product, in this case it's very naive, it's just one endpoint, but when you have defined a product, then you can create these portals. Let's take this one, that's the one we have prepared. I haven't really configured any of this because, well, it's just for fun, but so it looks a little bit corny, but that's the way it is. Then if you sign in as a developer, let's say I'm a front-end developer who wants to make an application that is going to use my books backend API to make a bookstore. I log in here. I'm not sure this is going to work because I think the password is wrong, yes. But I can create a new account, and I can log in here, and then I register an application that I describe, and I get an API key back, all without any of the administrators or any of the creators of the application have to do anything. So you have this strong concept of a user. And a user can have more than one app. And that is all something you can get an overview of over in your kind of developer portal. So the handling of all this becomes a lot easier. And what is also cool is that, as I mentioned, you can have these different layers of products. So it's, say, a premium product and a basic product. And if we try to see what that looks like, I have made this small application, if we can find it. Not that one. Ah, it's here. A small application that sends requests to the backend. And if we start having that to run now, it's not super big, I know, but I think it's big enough that you can see what's going on. Now it's sending requests to the API through the Apigee endpoint. And you see most of, right now, all the results are 200 that are successful. They take about a second. That's the latency. That's the developer. That's the application. And this is the book that the application requests. This is just random data based on a small kind of database of the users that are registered. And now you see something like this. That's a 429. That's because that user runs into his quota now. So he's in the basic usage kind of tier. So he can only have 10 requests a minute. And that means that at some point he starts to run, or she starts to run into these kind of blocks. Once you kind of get the basic XML stuff set up for this, it is no more than just going into your products. Let's see if we can find it. Yes, bookshelf premium, 10. This is basic, 10 requests a minute. So this is a relatively easy way to enforce these kind of quotas. I am at 6:05 now, so I'll shut this down. This is just kind of a small taste of Apigee, and well, now it almost sounds like I'm trying to sell this stuff. I'm not. But what I have seen when I have tried to work with this is that there are some things that you might think should be simple enough that in the solutions I have tried, are not just something that works out of the box. If you spend a little more time doing some of that in Apigee, you actually get some pretty good results relatively fast. As I said, I don't know what it costs, but they have a free tier that you can use, and I have been running this on free tier for months. There are request limits, so if you request it too much, you will get the 429s. But if you have a small hobby project or a small, you know, if I were to make a bookstore, maybe I would use Apigee. just in the free tier level. Then when the bookstore becomes big and I start to make millions, then maybe I would go over to the more kind of enterprise ready version of Apigee, and it can scale to whatever level you need. I think we stop this now, and I will say thank you very much for your attention.